In case you people plan to study this, this is called the functional margin. This is given the name, the functional margin. In support vector machines, it's called functional margins, okay? The whole objective is first find out the right classifiers who don't do any mistakes in true positives and true negatives. Once you found out those classifiers, now within these many classifiers, how do you find the max margin classifier? We have understood the concept, how it happens, but it doesn't create a table. In the table, insert all these values. It doesn't do it this way. This is only conceptual. It uses something else to find the best fit plane, so that you don't have to go and look for infinite number of planes. So I'm going to take you that part. After that part, we'll stop. We'll have discussions. Then we'll continue with the hands-on. Okay? So even if you're not getting the mathematics part, don't worry about those things. It's not required. It's only for in case you're interested how it works. So don't need to remember any of the formulas. So all of you, okay, why did we come out with this term? Okay, let's move on. So the whole objective is, I'm going to replace this with FI. This is called FI, we call it FI, functional margins, FI. So the objective is to find out from all the different planes, that plane which has maximum FI, functional margin. Now look at this. This is going to be slightly slippery, but have a look at this. We started with minus 0.4x1 plus, what is that, x2 and minus 9 equal to 0, right? Minus x2. Minus x2, this is 1. Plus 9 is equal to 0, right? This is what we started with. Now, if I give you one more line, say this is minus 4x1 minus 10x2 plus 90 is equal to 0. They look like two different lines, but they are the same lines. They look like two different lines, but they are the same lines. There's no difference, okay? Instead of saying 1 kilogram, I'm saying 1,000 grams. It's the same line in the mathematical space represented by two different expressions. However, when you put this equation into this format, yi into, this will give you a smaller number, this will give you a larger number. So we are still in a problem. The problem is two different expressions of the same line can mislead the algorithm. To prevent this from misleading the algorithm, we do some magic over here. And the magic, I'll just tell you what it is. We divide this equation. Don't worry too much about these things. We divide this equation by W and this by W. Now, this is where it becomes slightly strange. What the hell is going on? Okay, so I need to explain this to you. Whenever you have a line, you know the slope of the line, y equal to mx plus c. This is the expression we have been seeing till date. Okay, this slope, geometrically you can prove it, you can actually establish, it's a vector which is perpendicular to this line. Okay, whenever you have a line or a plane, there are two vectors associated with it. One is called directional vector, one is called normal vector. This normal vector is W. Okay, now I showed you two expressions, one was larger scale, one was smaller scale. The only difference between these two expressions which I showed you, 0.41 and minus 9, 4, 10, and 90. The only difference between these two equations is, geometrically, this is W1, the first one. This will be W2. Same vector scaled up, this will be W2. But both of these vectors show the same line. Okay? So in functional margin, the problem is, when you're using this W terms over here, same equation can be again and again evaluated to find the maximum distance and all the distance between data points and all those things. Okay, so what we do is, any data point, the distance between the point and the data point, which is called functional margin, this functional margin is expressed in terms of how much W is there inside this. If you remember, what is standard deviation? xi minus x bar, what is this? Distance from x bar, the central point, raised to power 2 by n under root, right? So then we say z score is xi minus x bar, the distance in terms of standard deviation. Remember z score? What we are doing here is scaling. So the z score function is done by w here. And this xi minus x bar is this. So xi minus x bar by w, it is, you're scaling it. You're converting it to form of scaled data set. Nothing else. Now with this equation, I promise we'll not go beyond this. With this equation, the objective is find out that plane where this, for every plane you find out the minimum fi, list it out, then once you divide by fi, I'm sorry, this is not called fi, this is called geometric margin now. Once you divide by w, it's called geometric margin. This becomes GM, geometric margin. The objective is find out the minimum geometric margin of all the planes, pick up that geometric margin, which is the max. That becomes your objective. Now look at this equation. How can you maximize this? How can you maximize this? Either maximize the numerator or minimize the denominator. So the objective becomes, I have to reduce W, minimize W. To maximize this, minimize this. The smaller this is, the larger this will be. Because in this whole expression, there's a W here. When you minimize this, this becomes small, this becomes small. Deciding factor. So when this becomes small, this becomes very large, this becomes very large. Look at the expression properly. To maximize my GM, I have to minimize my W. How do we choose bias? Again, the bias and the slopes are decided by the algorithm, which cleanly separates out the two classes. Okay, so finally, the overall objective of support vector machines is minimize the slopes, while doing it, maximize the geometric margin. Find the plane which has maximal geometric margins from the nearest points in the two data sets. Okay, this combination, when you come across where you're minimizing something, so what they do is they turn it this into W square to make it quadratic, because quadratic has a particular property where it becomes easy to solve. This combination, when you do it, to solve this combination, they use a mathematical function called Lagrange's. Don't worry too much about these things. In the Lagrange's, we put both these expressions, this one and this one. The overall objective is to minimize this. Then this further takes you to the other mathematical constructs. You want to hear those words? You don't need to memorize them. Just forget them after this class. Whenever this Lagrange's is used, and in the Lagrange's, one of the equations here is greater than or equal to 0. I forgot to mention this in the equations. When one of them is open-ended, then this has to meet certain conditions called KKT. KKT conditions, Karush Kuhn-Tucker conditions. If you're meeting this condition, and if you're meeting another condition called Slater's condition, I'm just making sure you never ever ask me to go into the depths of it. Still, don't worry about these things. Every algorithm has these kind of inbuilt mathematical constructs on the basis of which they run. When you're learning neural networks, my God, so many of them run underneath. Okay, if it meets Slater's condition, that means this particular problem statement is called strong dual. I'll just one more step, then I'll stop. It's a strong dual problem. What the strong dual problem means is, in the mathematical space, you're trying to minimize something, at the same time you're trying to maximize something. And this guarantees you, you're trying to minimize this. This is this curve. You're trying to maximize this. That is this curve. when you, what this later condition says is, if it is a strong dual problem, you just minimize, instead of minimizing, you just maximize one, you'll find the solution for the other one also. You don't need to solve them separately. Just solve one equation, one constraint, the other one will automatically get taken care of. You don't need to worry about it. That's what this states. Using all this funda, it finds out for you the hyperplane, which traverses right between the center of the two nearest points from the two different classes.